Michigan. Change. No change. Revolution.
Hi, my name is Ismene Souza and I run the chesscomputers.org website. In this documentary, we're going to take a look at the history of these machines, starting with the very first commercially available chess computer, going all the way to the latest innovations in these machines as well. And also, we're going to take a look at those who collect chess computers and how they organize their collections and what is involved in doing so, along with some interesting things about the history of chess computers. So join me and we're going to have some fun.
What music can describe the royal game of chess?
The timeless tunes of J.S. Bach can do it best.
Just as the player analyzes lines of logic, hows and whys, and deep in concentration tries to find the path that...
Chess is a game that has fascinated many for a long time. And to many, the marriage between chess and computers is just natural. Probably the first attempt to a mechanical or automated chess machine was the Turk, which was really a hoax, but it is interesting, its story. It debuted in 1769, was the work of an Austrian, Baron Wolfgang von Kempelen, and it was later exposed as the hoax it was. But until then, it fascinated a lot of people all over the world, and many who saw the Turk playing were astounded by what it could do. It had basically a little guy inside of it, which was the process by which the pieces moved, but when showing to the public, the people would see actually the mechanics inside the box, and most of them had no idea of what was going on. And again, it was a hoax, but it was some could say a first step into what was fascinating people with which was the idea that humans could play chess against a machine. And that's the part that was interesting. The first real attempt at developing a chess playing machine was by a Spanish scientist named Leonardo Torres y Quevedo in 1890. And although it was a very simple concept, it was really, we could say, a breakthrough, because for its time it was very ingenious and it was a real chess playing machine, we could say, not a hoax. And that's why it deserves its entry in the chess computer history. In the 1940s and 50s, we saw the development of real computers. And with that, a lot of people started thinking about using them for playing chess. In 1949, computer pioneer Claude Shannon published an article called Programming a Computer for Playing Chess. And that was a very interesting article. And by the 60s, computers were good enough so that they could play average chess. And with that, we came to the 70s, where the fun really began.
We'll be right back.
This is the Chess Challenger 1 by Fidelity Electronics. And it was, as we said, the very first commercially available chess computer. Also, shortly after the CC1 was released, the Chess Challenger 1 is called CC1 sometimes. They also released the Chess Challenger 3, or CC3. And if you look at the boxes, it's kind of hard to tell the difference between the two. But let's take a look at the CC1 first and see why it is so special. Keep in mind, this was released in 1977, so you're talking 30 years ago. So some of the things you see, you have to keep in mind that the technology at the time was not that advanced. The instruction manual, and here's the computer. You can easily identify a Chess Challenger 1 because of a mix-up that Fidelity did in regards to how the ranks and the files were labeled on the board. As you can see, you have the numbers here and here the letters. Now that may explain very hard if you're used to the standard notation on the board. It had only one level of play, that's why it was called the Chess Challenger 1, and the computer only played with the blacks. So let's turn it on so you can take a look at how the notation looks like on the display. There we have it. Let's turn it on. And nothing special about the display, but to make a move, let's say we want to play kind of a standard opening here, queen's pawn to here. It'll be 4b to 4d. So let's try that here. Okay, so it's ready for us to play. Let's enter our move here. 4D. Oops, 4B. 4B to 4D. So let's enter here. 4 and D, which is on the same key. Press enter, and the computer responds with 4G to 4E. Here we are, 4G to 4E. And we make a second move. Let's just make one more move here. Let's move our knight here from 2A to here, which would be 3C. We said 2A to 3C. There we have it. Enter. And the computer responds with 2H, 3F. Can you really imagine playing a full game of chess on a computer like this? Look at the notation.
H, G, F, E, D, C, B, A.
E, D, C.
What's also interesting is this letter that was included in the manual. And as you can see here, it's very interesting because it says here that initially you may find that chess challengers may appear to be making an illegal move. However, this is highly unlikely. Well, what happens is, in truth, in reality, the Chess Challenger one not only accepts illegal moves, but it also makes them. Some people have played with the Chess Challenge and found out that it does make quite a number of illegal moves. But let's look at the CC3 next and see how they correct a lot of those problems. There's some confusion as to which box belongs to which computer, because as we said, the Chess Challenger 3 was released right after the Chess Challenger 1. And here, these two boxes, one is for the CC1, the other one for the CC3. One thing in the manual, if you look in the back, there was an option here for you to upgrade your Chess Challenger for $75. The idea was that you could send your computer back to Fidelity in Chicago and they would send you the upgraded version, which would be the CC3. Well, and you see here the date after June 1st, 1977. Well, from what I have found out, looks like in the boxes, initially, they were pretty much the same, but there was this little yellow sticker here which would indicate an upgrade. So in the box you would still see the picture of the CC1 with the reverse notation here, and this is the CC1, the original. Now later on, Fidelity released the CC3 and they changed the box a little bit. If you see here now, it shows three levels of play, which is the CC3, and the picture now shows the board as they corrected with the letters and numbers in the right position. So let's take a look at the CC3 here. On some of the manuals you can see here, it actually shows, indicates here that this is the upgraded version, and the biggest difference being the three levels of play. So let's unpack it, turn it on, and take a look at it. So here is the CC3. As soon as you turn it on, you can see the difference here, because this initial display shows the level of play. We can cycle through the levels by pressing CL. Level 2, level 3, back to level 1. And you can see that the notation has been corrected. Now we have the letters and the numbers in the right position. So it's much easier to play with this one. Other than that, it's pretty much the same casing and same pieces. So here they are side by side, the CC1 and the CC3.
In Miami, Florida, USA, one can go and visit the World Chess Hall of Fame, which is a chess museum, and also Excalibur Electronics. There you can actually see a Chess Challenger 1 and one of the prototypes for the Chess Challenger 1. Also you can see a video where Ron Nelson and Sid Samuel talk about the creation of the Chess Challenger 1. Now I have to apologize, for I taped the video off of the monitor that was playing in the museum, so the quality is really bad, it's really not that great, but it's very important to take a look at what they have to say about this historical chess computer. And as you watch them talking about the CC1, keep in mind that all of this took place 30 years ago. A lot changed since the early days in terms of computing power, as we will see in a few minutes. But let's then hear Ron Nelson and Sid Samuel talking about the Chess Challenger 1.
In the middle 1970s, a major revolution occurred.
I invented it 19 years ago while watching a Star Trek episode, and Spock was playing against a computer. And I came to my office the next day, spoke to my secretary, and she had a boyfriend who worked for Zenith Radio, who was kind of dabbling. dabbling in this.
And I'm sure kept in the back of his mind, you'd have to be great if anybody could play chess. And that was the beauty of the chess challenger, was that anybody could sit down and be alone and play somebody in chess.
After 6 months, Ron came back to Cincinnati with his prototype of what was to be the Fidelity Chess Challenger, the first affordable electronic chess computer. This idea was quite revolutionary at the time. Knowledgeable computer experts were arguing that a computer devoted solely to chess would be too expensive to build. Sid brought together the best programmers he could find, and soon small chess computers were appearing in stores everywhere under the Fidelity brand. Thereafter, an international market was established, and the U.S. took the lead in the development of chess computers that anyone can buy. Electronic chess sets were everywhere.
This season, give them something to think about from the TV and electronics department at Bloomingdale's. Here's Sid Simoli, president of Fidelity Electronics.
Listen to the voice of Bridge Challenger. Along with our chess challenger, they're the world's most advanced talking computerized games. Both are easy enough for the beginner, yet challenging to the most advanced player. And best of all, they don't cheat.
The TV and electronics department at Bloomingdale's. It's like no other store in the world.
Mikhail Botvinnik, the sixth chess world champion, contributed many original ideas to the development of the chess computer. But unfortunately, during the period of his research, he was limited by the scarceness of available computer time in the old Soviet Union. Another great accomplishment occurred in the 1980s, when Hans Berliner's computer program, Hi-Tech, achieved master strength, and then defeated Grandmaster Arnold Denker for the first victory by a computer over a Grandmaster. Fidelity started creating new chess sets, with many having improved, to make his game even stronger. Ron Nelson, with assistance from Dan and Kathy Spracklin, developed a super strong program designed to challenge the toughest of players. Awards started to pour in. Fidelity began winning some of the most prestigious international competitions for electronic chess. Famous chess celebrities were even using Fidelity chess computers as sparring partners. Electronic chess truly became mainstream.
To come out with new features, we introduced a unit that moved its own pieces. We introduced a unit that actually had a sensor so that when you walked up to the device, the chess game, it would know you were there and start talking to you.
With each new device were new challenges.
My goal is to make it easy to play, to have children be able to play and learn it quickly and have fun with the machine. And just have it be a fun game.
A lot has changed since the Fidelity days. Now the commercial chess computer comes in all shapes, colors, and sizes. Some much more powerful than the original tabletop models and can even fit in your shirt pocket. People of all ages, all over the world, relax and it from their commercially available chess computers, playing a game whenever they wish. Sidney Simoli, inspired by an idea from science fiction, realized man's centuries-old dream of creating a machine that played chess without a human hiding inside and made it accessible to everyone.
I bought a chess computer. People asked me why. I said somebody sent me a move in January and I have to answer it by July.
After Fidelity released the Chess Challenger series, other companies came up with their own chess computers. Two early models include the CompuChess, which was pretty much a calculator. It just had the keyboard where you key in the moves. And also Boris, pretty much the same concept, except that Boris did have a board and the pieces. Many advancements were made in a short period of time. For example, the CompuChess, even though it was still an early model, it had 6 levels of intelligence, as they called, randomized strategy, and could even solve problems. So things really started to get interesting at that time. One time I took some of my chess computers to the Pittsburgh Chess Club The idea was to see how many people could tell which one was the first chess computer ever made. So I had the CompuChess, the Boris, the VideoMaster, and the Chess Challenger 1. And let's see if anyone could guess which one was the first chess computer ever made.
Which one do you think?
I think they'll say either one of these. I'd probably say this would be the first.
This one?
Yeah.
Okay. So,
something like these right out of the 70s.
I think either of the CompuChess or the Chess Champion. Or maybe the Boris. I know it's not that one. It has to be one of these two. That's what I know.
Yeah. I'm just looking at anything that might give it away.
Mm-hmm. Well, sometimes you can just tell it by how the buttons are.
I'm looking for ones that have descriptive notation. That would help.
You know what? It might be that one because it has the on, off, and reset in the same thing, while this has to have two different switches.
That means it evolved.
Uh-huh. So I think CompuChess was first. And that one was second. No, you know what? It might have been one of these two.
That's interesting.
Because there's two switches here. And it might be stupid. I'm wondering about this one. Where's the cord for?
Well, at the end, nobody was really able to figure it out that it was the Chess Challenger one. But it was a nice visit to the Pittsburgh Chess Club.
I move up here. Oh, is it my move?
One thing about chess computers is that they literally come in all sizes and shapes.
From the early 90s, and it was made by a company in the Netherlands, a Dutch company named Task. And some of the features of these computers are still amazing by today's standard of technology. So let's take a quick look at what it does.
There are two units, the board and the pieces, and the actual chess computer. So let's first take a look at the board. It's a nice design board, but what makes it different from other computers is that the pieces, though they may look like ordinary pieces, they're actually intelligent. That means these pieces, they have electronics inside of them so that the board can, with the computer, identify the pieces. In other words, it knows not only that a piece is a pawn or a knight, but it knows the color as well. Let's see how that works. The computer is very advanced. When you turn it on, you can see through the series of menus, all the different options that you have, and to show you how the piece recognition system works, we're going to take a look at setting up the position for the pieces. This module is called the R30, Task R30, because the microprocessor is, the CPU is a 30 megahertz system. And you can see it right here on the display with the version 512 kilobytes of RAM. But let's take a look at the piece recognition, and for that you're going to come to the menu and select the position setup. One thing that you notice is right here you have a graphical display of how the pieces look in the board. So as we move one piece from the board, you notice how it disappears from here. In this case, taking off the rook and the knight. So as you can see here, it shows that they're not there. As I put them back up, the computer automatically recognizes those pieces. So that's really the interesting part about it. Because of the piece recognition system, you can even tell if the initial setup is wrong. For instance, in this case, as you can see, I switched the queen and the king. So it's telling me by the LEDs here that there's something wrong with the pieces. If I put them in the right position, see, now it knows that it's ready to play a game. The board also has a total of 81 LEDs, and they're used to indicate the moves, so you don't actually need to look at the display. Let's show how that works. Let's start to play a game here. So you can see here how it's indicating what piece we should move for him, the to and from. Let's try a second move here. So you can see how you can really tell without looking at the display what pieces you should move. Here you can see how it tells us to move the knight. And on the display, you can follow the game as you can see here. And you can actually change here how the display looks like. You can follow here the graphical display. You can show detailed information about the game. And it's really a very nice, very powerful system. You can see the two clocks. And you even have those little devices here to simulate what a standard chess clock looks like. So you have all the look and feel of a really nice chess board with an advanced computer inside of it.
There is also what is called the R40 model, which is very rare. Only 20 units were ever sold.
Now let's take a look at some of the smallest chess computers ever. And most of them, the ones that we are going to look at, are really in the form of a pocket calculator. They're really small, and even though they don't have a really good playing strength, they're very interesting because of their size. So let's take a look at them. The ones that we have here are actually copies. For example, you see the Mephisto is pretty much the same as the SciTech here. So let's see what they look like. As you can see, it works as a real calculator. You can actually do math.
I'm the operator with my pocket calculator.
Or you can switch the mode. And play chess. So you just enter your coordinate.
I am adding and subtracting.
And the computer gives his response.
I'm controlling.
And this model has a drawer here that you can open, and you have a full small chess set that you can play with.
I'm the operator with my pocket calculator.
We're talking to Ruud Martin from the Netherlands. He is the creator of the Resurrection module for Mephisto boards. Ruud, first, thank you so much for taking this time to talk to us. Let's start by asking, how did you get involved with chess computers?
Well, that's about 4 years ago. I bought my first chess computer, which was a Mephisto exclusive Polgar, on the internet through eBay. And I have been programming when I was young. My age was around 15. And my own program, which was based on a 6502 processor. And well, it was somehow for about 10, 12 years quiet after that when I wrote the program. And then I stumbled on the internet on this beautiful exclusive computer. And I couldn't resist it, so I bought it. And that was the first time I was getting interested in this material.
Why did you decide to create a new module for those boards, for the Mephisto chess computer boards?
Well, there were a lot of things which were successive steps in it. As I told you, I programmed a small computer, which was a single card computer based on a 6502 with my own chess program. And the Polgar had the 6502 program as well. Based on this, I was very interested on how this system was designed, how it was built. Maybe I had something like, why didn't I think of this about 15 years ago to build it myself? But, well, there were things more important in life at that moment. So I decided to re-engineer the complete Polgar system and find out how it works. And it took me about a year. I started writing an emulator on the Windows system, which could emulate the complete Polgar module based on a task board. Maybe you seen this program, Ismenio?
Well, can you tell us a little bit about it?
Well, it was about 1.5 years ago. I programmed it for a Windows system. It's a small interface, and it emulates the complete Polgar module, but then interfacing to a task board. I didn't mention it a lot, maybe only on Schachcomputer AT, but that was the first step I made, and that's why I had so much knowledge build up in 1.5 years. About the Mephisto board and about the way the modules works.
Did you get help from the folks from Mephisto or SciTech, or did you have to do it all on your own?
Correct. There wasn't any help at all. I tried to reach Mephisto or SciTech, but they were not interested in telling the technique behind the systems. So I figured it out all by myself.
Well, that's really amazing, Ruud. I give you a lot of credit for that. Now, why did you choose the name Resurrection for the module?
Well, it was a kind of a bet in Leiden. We have in Holland a yearly tournament, which is called the Gebruikers Tournament. And at this tournament, I made a bet that I said, well, I can build it myself. And of course, I was looking for a good name for it. And a good friend of me, mine, Hein Veldhuis, which is working on a complete encyclopedia for chess computers. It's a very big thing he's doing. And he sent me an email, why don't call it Resurrection? and he had some more names, but his first impression of Resurrection was that it was a good name, while Resurrection means coming out of the ashes, which is the phoenix bird, the firebird, and it says it all. There was no module for about 10 years, and there was a new module which I built, so Resurrection was a very good name. Secondly, but that was after I decided to name it the Resurrection, is that if you analyze the tournaments and the chess games of Resurrection against other computers, you will see that in the first 20 moves it will play even or even lose, but on the end, because it has so much computer power, it always, well, mostly always wins, because it looks very much further in the tree of the chess game. And that's the second thing why Resurrection is such a good name, after all, then.
Okay, and we also talked a little bit about some of the problems you had at the beginning, but what other challenges did you face to complete this project?
Well, there were a lot. For example, if you would take the connector, which is the building block to connect the interface print to the exclusive board, there was no manufacturer in the which had it on stock. So I had to find out where it was sold, and of course I called Cytec if I could buy 30 or 40 pieces of them, but they were not interested at all. And finally I found out in a company in America who could buy it in somewhere, China, and it was, I had to buy 1,000 pieces, which was far too much. And I was lucky because they offered me a demo, or how you call that, a small amount, to check whether it's a feasible component to use, and I could buy 100 pieces. Well, this is just a small fragment of the complete module, but there were so many more problems which I had to overcome. Maybe I blew up some five exclusive boards, some academies and whatever, to find out how it works. And last week I had a problem with my new LCD, which was, how do you call that, fuming away. There was a lot of smoke coming out of it. And well, that's the hazards of finding out new paths to chess modules. But there were quite a lot of problems, Ismenia. Yeah, quite a lot.
Wow, that's really amazing. You went through all of that and you still completed your project. Congratulations on that. And in the end, how many modules do you actually produce?
Well, I was limited by Cytec for 25 modules. I still do not know if Cytec has the rights to limit it to 25, but I have honored it until this moment. I am talking to Cytec if it's possible to sell more. But at the moment, 25 pieces is good enough. It's about 20 pieces which are sold to people in the world, and 5 pieces which are, well, semi-sold, if I may say it that way, to some good chess computer friends in Holland, which have helped me out very on testing and on building the modules and such things. So it's maximized to 25, and I have to say that due to all press I get from all sites which are delivering information for Resurrection, I still get, well, 2 emails a week from people who want to buy the module. And at this time I just say, well, it's sold out, I'm sorry, and I put you on a list, maybe for the future, I don't know.
Well, that's a pretty good indicator of how successful the project was. You know, if you had not received all this attention or all these emails, that would be different. But as it is, the project was really successful.
Well, that's correct, because if I would look into all mails I've got from interested people who wanted to buy initially the Resurrection, I think it's over 200 mails from different people. But I have to say that the price, which is a shielded price but only known to the project members, but some do have some more information, was a big problem for a lot of those people. If I would say that 25 of those 200 people were willing to pay this price, it will be correct. Maybe at this time there are some more people, but not that much more, who are willing to pay the price I asked. But, well, that's a prize, I think, which belongs to the very limited series of 25. And I think Steve Blinko, who is an American chess friend, is very lucky to have the serial number one is Mania.
Well, pretty sure he is, especially being a top collector and now having the Resurrection number one, the very first one. That's something I'm sure he is very proud of. Now, Rude, can you explain, why do you think we still have all this interest in dedicated units when a software, a PC, would play a much better and stronger chess game?
What do you mean by dedicated unit, if I may?
Well, I'm talking about the a regular home PC running a chess software such as Fritz or Chess Master or something like that. That, as opposed to a computer with a board, a dedicated computer just to play chess.
Well, that's easy to explain, Ismanio. For about 10 years ago, the chess computer modular series were, fainted out of history because PCs were that powerful and that the modules at this time couldn't cope with the new PC technology. At this time, of course, it is also that PC technology is far ahead of, for example, the strong arm processor which I am using. But the strong arm processor I am using is at this time such good technology that I think most people, they do not care if it's a PC or a very good chess computer, embedded chess computer, because the current technology is that good, embedded technology, that they have a chess computer which is living up to the standards. So 10 years ago the PC was winning. At this time I think the embedded technology is that good that we can return to embedded technology, and therefore we can return to dedicated chess computers like the combination of Resurrection and the exclusive board.
Very well. So based on that, do you have any predictions for the future of dedicated chess computers?
Well, it's hard to see. If it were up to me, I would cooperate with a company like Cytec or DGT place my new technology and new way of thinking in the modular concept into one of their boards, like a DGT board or like a module in the Cytec system. But I know that, for example, Cytec at this time is probably going to release this year a new module. It says it on the internet site, which is going to bear the name of Kasparov, because Kasparov had said, well, I want to give my name to the strongest chess computer ever. And that's a problem at itself, because I know it will not be the strongest chess module. So a lot of things for the future, and I'll have to wait if Cytec or GST are interested to cooperate with me.
Okay. Well, thanks, Rude, so much for, again, taking the time to talk to us. I really appreciate your help, and I wish you all the best and success for the future.
Well, thank you very much. I enjoyed your site, and I enjoyed the support you have given me through your site to the world for Resurrection, and I'll hope to give a second interview in the future if there are new aspects ahead.
So we're here with John Dutton, and he's going to share some information with us about chess computers. So John, tell us about yourself and what's in your involvement. How did you work with chess computers?
I worked for the United States Chess Federation 1990-1991. And there I was in the sales department, and what I did was help people decide what kind of equipment that they needed or wanted, both in books, pieces, and chess computers.
Okay. And what computers would you say were the ones that would sell the most popular ones?
At that time, the main products that the U.S. Chess Federation, which I'll call USCF from now on, sold were Fidelity products. Excalibur didn't exist at that time. It was Fidelity Electronics. Mm-hmm. And There were some Satec products, not very many. They were relatively a new supplier in the market. And Novag, which is out of Hong Kong, was also a big supplier. At that time, they had probably the strongest chess-playing computers of that day. At that time, the Novag computers were the strongest computers. They were playing master level and above, and they had pretty fast processors, so that they play the move quickly. Because on a chess computer, the stronger you want it to play, the longer it takes to make the move, because it thinks deeper. They call them plies, which is a half move. So if you wanted to play strong, it would search deeper into its knowledge, and it would take longer to make the move. Playing it on the highest level, it could take a half an hour to make a move. So you want one that plays strong and also plays quickly if you want to play quick games.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any history about recalls, computers that were not really good sellers or that gave you a lot of trouble?
The Fidelity company came out with one called a Travel Master. It was a very small unit that opened up. It was smaller than a videotape, and it was supposed to be rated over 2,000. It had both little round discs and actually vertical 3D pieces, as they call them. And it was supposed to be, going to be a real good seller. The problem is that when the USEF started selling them, it seemed like that for every five that they sold, two got returned. Wow. There were some engineering problems with that unit, because the board, being on both parts and opening up, had a ribbon cable between the two. Mm-hmm. And it didn't seem to hold up, and squares started dying. The unit worked fine, except for the squares dying. Mm-hmm. So that was sort of a disaster. And I personally, when people were asking about portable computers, that's one that I just didn't pay too much attention to. I sort of forgot about it. I was concerned about the USEF and all the returns, because their policy was you didn't have to pay the shipping back, they'd give you back the money. And that was costly. They stood behind the products, but the product needed more. Basically, the other computers that they sold were pretty reliable. I don't think that the defective rate was, out of order on any of them, especially since the number that they sold.
Can you tell us about the rating system? How did they rate the computers?
Okay, back in the late 80s and the 90s, the USEF would hire a good player, such as a grandmaster, usually with a rating of 2,500, and they would have him play these games, 100 games against the same computer, and then rate the computer as if it was a live person. This is the way they did this for quite a while. And now the USEF isn't in the position of rating computers any longer. Probably because it got kind of expensive. The grandmasters have found out that they can make money playing chess. and they do that now. They don't do anything for nothing. So the USEF has just sort of stopped rating it. Up until then, if you saw a little insignia on a box that says USEF certified, that's the way that one was done. If it doesn't have the USEF insignia on it as being rated, that means the company has found another way. Either they have gotten a grandmaster to do it, and those are anonymous grandmasters. I've never seen the names of who did them. They're estimating it by the program that is being used by the computer. And they're pretty accurate, but the USEF, as being the governing body in the U.S., had a had a certain strength to it when they put their insignia on there.
Mm-hmm. Well, thanks, John, for taking the time to talk to us.
It's my pleasure.
We're talking to Sue Winkler, who worked at Fidelity. And Sue, first of all, thank you so much for taking this time to talk to us. And can I ask you, what was your work at Fidelity at the time?
Okay. Well, I worked in the billing shipping department, and I was in charge of, like, taking in stuff for repairs, warranty, and I filed the warranty paperwork.
How big was the company at that time?
I'm going to say everything before Chess Challenger was probably under 25 people.
Wow.
25, if that.
And can you describe, you mentioned, I think you saw the prototype, right?
Yes, I saw the original, which was huge. It was pretty large. I'm going to say, like, size of a TV, kind of like upside down where, like, the screen is facing up. If it was laying on its back. It looked like it was made of, like, maybe plywood. Fairly good sized. I'm going to say about the size of a 19-inch TV, but it might be a little smaller than that, but not much. It was very crude looking. You know, it was like somebody, like, made in a garage kind of thing. So I really did see the very original.
Okay. And once they started producing the Chess Challenger 1, where did they build them? Was that in the same building where they used
it? No. Well, when we first started, making the Chess Challenger, they got right across the street from our building. They acquired in our building. I don't know if they rented it or bought it. I don't remember. And now all of a sudden, like, we went from, let's say, 25 people to over 100. And it seemed like overnight.
Wow.
They started making them. It was a small, very small. I don't know how, I really, because I was more the biomedical, because that's when I started the company, it was biomedical. And then all of a sudden now they have a new division, and the new division was across the street, and the new division was the game division. And it was funny because we had a time clock, and the time clock was maybe 25 feet from where I worked in our little small break room. And everybody from across the street would have to come over, and it would be a line to go clock out at 5 o'clock. And it was so funny because it would, like, be... took us like seconds to click, you know, check out, and then when we, like, almost like tripled or quadrupled, almost literally overnight, we had to stand in line to check out. So,
wow,
I do remember that. It was kind of comical.
Mm-hmm. Did you have any idea at the time that they were doing really something that would be historical in a way, the first consumer electronic chess computer?
Maybe a little bit, just because nobody had done it before. And I did ask one of the Simoli brothers, I'm going to say Myron, because I talked to him more. Because it was a small office. I mean, it wasn't hardly anybody, you know, it was a small company. And I remember it's like, well, how come we don't have a copyright or, you know, or something like that, you know, or like a patent. And he says, we can't patent a game, you know, you can't patent a game. That's what he told me. That was already, you know, I said, well, we're the first ones to do it. And he goes, but, you know, somebody else invented the game. They're just making the game better.
Okay.
So that's what I was told by Myron Simoli, as far as, like, a patent. So... You know, I said, well, somebody could steal the idea, and he goes, yeah, unfortunately, you can't. And, well, then there was a bunch of knockoffs after that, so.
Uh-huh.
But, it was, like, big. I mean, we were, like, small company, it seemed like. I worked there, like, about 10 months, and it was a small company, and we were almost, like, a household name, it seemed like, overnight. It just seemed like that.
Wow.
Because a lot of people were talking about the Chess Challenger, and it was, like, stuff on the news about it, and a lot of people were talking about it, and there was some articles on it, I believe. I mean, I'm not literally, household name, but it just seemed like it, you know? Like, a lot of people were talking about it, people, like, they didn't even know who I worked for, and I was, like, people were talking about it. I remember, you know, friends, and they're like, hey, there's this really cool thing I want for Christmas or something. I was like, yeah, I know what it is, you know?
Well, I want to thank you again for taking this time to talk to us.
The internet became a very important source of information about chess computers. We're not just talking about eBay, where most collectors find their computers. And even some of the new ones have started their collection using eBay. But also, especially within the past couple of years, we have seen a number of sites that are focusing on those dedicated chess computers. And so let's take a look at what we can find on the web. This is by no means a comprehensive list, but we're going to take a look at some of the websites that have been around for a while and some of the new ones, and what type of information we can find on them.
Let's start by taking a look at the Overtom Collection, which is a website that belongs to a friendly Dutchman, Tom Loof, and he has hundreds of computers. And he also runs his website, which is overton.nl. The site is well organized. He has lots of information, and you can find technical information about all of his computers, and he has them organized manufacturer. And what I also liked is his catalog, and especially the pictures. I like the way he pictures his computers. You can see them very, you can see how nicely he takes care of them. And also, from time to time, Tom posts information on his weblog about chess and computers. And is it very interesting, because he, for example, when he buys some of the computers, he may be able to open them up, and he does post pictures and what he finds about them. So you can really read what is sometimes kind of a review of the computers that he has. So it's definitely a site that I recommend. It helped me when I started collecting chess computers a few years ago. What is also interesting is that he has the computers playing against each other. So you can read about similar computers. You can read what Tom has to say about their strengths, their levels of play, the type of playing. And you can replay the games right on your browser. So again, the website is overton.nl. And by the way, he is a member on our forum, so you can contact Tom there as well. Another site that is a must-see is from a French collector. He is Alain Zanqueta, I believe. I hope I'm pronouncing his name right. But his site is great source of information. One thing that makes it very, very valuable is the fact that he has made available online for download, free of charge, lots of manuals. In fact, he encourages people to send him copies of the manuals. He has in different languages. He scans the manual. He posts them in PDF format. So he has helped a lot of people who have lost their manuals, or people who trying to get information about some computers to find them by looking at his website. He also has a very, very nice collection. He does take great pictures of his computers, and he has some nice features to his site. For example, you can even compare different boards if you're running certain types of browsers and the Windows operating system. Also, what is great about his site is the fact that you can also swap some computers. You can find information about his wanted list and things like that. So it's definitely a site that you want to see. He's very friendly. Again, he's also a member of the forum. You can also browse his collection. He does have technical information about his the computers in his collection, and it's one of the greatest sites on the web if you're looking for chess computers. This is probably the first site ever that was created and dedicated to chess computers. It's in German. It's from one of the biggest collector in the entire world, Kurt Kispert. I hope I'm saying that name right. And you can find some very, very rare computers here. Some of the ones that only a few people in the world have. And also, very nice pictures. There are two forums, one where you can ask questions about computers, even in English, and another forum dedicated to exchange, selling, and dealing with chess computers. So it's definitely a sight to see. A very nice addition in the recent years is the elpeon.com, which is run by Jose, which is German, and his site is definitely one that you want to take a look at, because not only he has, it's another one well designed where he has lots of information, he keeps track of prices, a computer market, what are chess computers selling for on eBay. So you can see past auctions and you can have an idea of how much you should expect to pay for a certain computer and so on. So it's definitely a very nice source of information. Looks like he works very hard to keep it updated. And again, you can find detailed information about most of those auctions. And he has links to lots of other sites. And it's another site that you want to bookmark and take a look at to visit. And he is also a member of the chesscomputers.org forum and website, so you can contact him there as well. Another recommended site is the chesscomputeruk.com, which has the collection and information of the collection from Mike Waters, who is an English collector. You can find lots of useful information. What's really impressive is the timeline that Mike was able to put together, where you can see the different manufacturers and models and the time of their release. So it's an invaluable source of information for collectors who want to maybe focus on a specific period of time, or if you want to see when a certain computer was released. You can also see his collection and contact Mike there. He's always available to trade computers. He's always looking for specific models. I believe he focuses mostly on the ones from the 80s, and he's very friendly. Another member from our forum, and it's another site that we recommend that you take a look at to get information about chess computers. So another one for your list. This next one is certainly one of my very favorite ones, schachcomputer.info. It's in German, but it's a great source of information. It has a very nice forum with lots of members. But what I believe is one of the most impressive features of this site is the Wiki, which is really a virtual encyclopedia of chess computers, which is maintained by volunteers. And you can find really good, detailed information about lots of computers. And you can even contribute to the encyclopedia by submitting your own information. You have lots of nice pictures. You have good technical information, including information that can help you if you're missing in a power adapter or something like that. So you can use a web-based translator to translate into other languages, since it is primarily in German. But it's definitely an excellent site that you should visit. And of course, there is our own website, chesscomputers.org, chesscomputers.org, where you can find information about my own collection. We can find links to other sites. You can find also an archive of the most of the website for the Tusk chess system. So it's an interesting source of information as well, though I haven't had time to update it lately. I plan to do so in the future. Also, you find a link to the list of current, most of the chess computers that you can buy on eBay just by clicking there. There are quite a number of other sites, like the Spanish Museum of Chess Computers, which has also quite a bit of information, including a forum. There's a site from Stephen from the forum where you can buy computers, some other French sites, even an Australian one. And also, we really could not possibly list all there are. There is a site from Steve Blinko where you can see pictures. It's really nice to see that there are many sites and information out there about chess computers. So start searching. I will now show you some of the computers in my collection. We wouldn't have time to show all of them, so I'll just pick some of the ones that I like the most. Some collectors have actually, believe it or not, hundreds of them. But I'll just show you some of the ones that I like. Like this one here, which is the Mephisto exclusive board with the Module 5. As you can see, it's a very, very beautiful and nice board. And it has the concept of modules, which is really interesting. It's very smart move. That means that the modules that you can see here, they are interchangeable. So with the same board, you can actually replace the display and the actual modules. So let's take the module out, and you can see what it looks like. So that means I can take this module, put it in a different board, or the display, or combination of both. What's also interesting about this one is that it had this unit, which is pretty much a portable computer. It has a nice sized board with magnetic pieces, but what's interesting is the module that you took from the exclusive board, you can just put into here. It runs with a 9-volt battery. And let's turn it on. And as you can see, you can pretty much play using the same module anywhere you go. So that is something that I really like about this Mephisto module. So here you can select the levels of play. You can have the computer play against itself. That's one of the things I really like about this computer. I really enjoy this particular model here. Now you put the modules back on the board. You can actually buy some of those modules separately from collectors or mostly on eBay. Now let's turn it on and you can see it. And here you can see It has a nice drawer that houses the units, and you can open and close and display using the board. Here we can reset to start a new game, and the display does show quite a bit of information. As you can see here, the computer is playing. You can have the computer play against itself, and the moves are indicated by the LEDs. So if you press enter, you can see the computer playing against itself. So again, it's a very, very nice board. It's one of my favorite computers. The ComChess is another computer that I liked. Also, it is also auto-sensory. However, this is a model that is famous for problems with the read switches. And a lot of collectors have had to replace the read switches on their boards. I never had a problem with this one, but it's not user-friendly. If you look at, unlike some of the other computers, it's not easy without the manual. It's very difficult to figure out how to set up options and things like that. The Excalibur Chess Station, it's a very interesting concept. It's not a rare computer at all. You can easily find it online. But I like it because it's two in one. You can play with the unit, just the handheld unit, or you can attach it to the board and play, and it's a pressure sensitive. The little Chester by Fidelity, which is a little version of the Phantom, the Chester, which you see later. It's one that I also like. In the handheld units, I do like the Deluxe Talk and Touch Chess by Excalibur, mostly because of the display. In dedicated chess computers, it's very hard to find one where the display really is nice to read and where the pieces are easily recognizable. And I think this model is by far one of the best in this regard. The Boris Diplomat is one that I also like, mostly because of the design, the concept. How you have the LEDs, the full board here, and the keypad right up front. It's one of the interesting computers, I think. Pocket and handheld units are some of my favorites, and I do like this Novag Micro Chess, which is PEG sensory. Some other handheld units. The Novag Escort is one model that I really like, especially because you can play with the unit, just the little handheld unit here. The Topaz, another one that I really enjoy because of its design and because it is a handheld unit. This one is a very, very retro looking computer where the handheld unit almost looks like one of those calculators right out of the 70s. The Fidelity Chess card, which is pretty much the same as this one, the Sphinx, which is one of those units that I really enjoy. You saw that before. It's pretty much the smallest chess computer ever made. You can actually play with just the unit. The actual chess computer is about the size of a credit card, and you just need to turn it on here. New game, you can select the level of play, and if you press move, the computer will play against itself. So you just need to keep pressing move and it will calculate the next move. It's definitely one of my favorites. This is another nice handheld unit, the Chess King, where you have the little unit and the board with the magnetic pieces. They actually say on the box that they are the world's smallest chess computer. Here we have the Travel Master, which you saw before during John Dutton's interview, but I have it out here so you can see it actually working. And that's the one here you can see with the 3D pieces, and it's a sensory board, so the magnetic pieces you can actually move just like this. For this one, I actually have an extra set of pieces. So here the flat round disc 3D pieces, and I still have the originals here, all wrapped, still in mint condition. And since I have the extra set, I can show you like this. So let's reset here, and you can see the how the display looks like. It's really a nice unit, but that's one that you have to be very careful about because of the ribbon that connects the two units. But let's take the pieces out and I'll show you how compact it is. So let's turn it off and close here, and there you have it. Really nice unit. The Chess Challenger 7 is an iconic chess computer because it was released in 1977, but it is the best-selling chess computer ever. I have found that looks like it sold around 600,000 units. So this is a common chess computer that you can easily find it today, but it's certainly a historical one. What's interesting is there was a clone, a Brazilian version of the CC7 called Byte. It was made by a company in Brazil called Splice Electronics. This one belonged to one employee of that company. I was able to get it from him, so it's probably one of the best units you can see out there. You have the manual, same as the one for the CC7, obviously in Portuguese. Even came with this. It's also hard, very hard to find how to play chess. The same yellow pattern. And you have the original pieces, which they're quite different from the ones for the CC7. Take a look at what they look like. I found out that this is pretty much a unauthorized copy of the CC7. I didn't find that the company had permissions from Fidelity to copy their product. And yet, I was able to open one that I repaired a few years ago, and it looks exactly like the CC7. Same processor, same electronics, and the same program. So it is a curious item, and it's hard to find as well. Sometimes they would release computers even with a nice case like this one, carrying case. It's a Master Series by Fidelity. This one, by the way, was made in Germany because Fidelity was, later on, the company was sold to the one that made the Mephisto product. So you can see this one here, made in Germany. So there was, this is kind of a nice model, which had, interestingly, this certificate by the U.S. Chess Federation of certifying the rating of 2325, which pretty much everyone agrees that's an inflated rating, but that's a nice carrying case for a nice computer.
I got the B player blues, B player blues.
Let's take a quick overview of the history of the major companies related to chess computers, starting with Fidelity Electronics, which was founded in 1976. Sid Samoli was the founder, and later on his son founded the Excalibur Electronics, kind of doing a kind of a continuation of Fidelity Electronics. You can see more about the history of the company at our website. What's also interesting is that Fidelity was later on sold to the company that made the Mephisto computers. Mephisto, which is also known as H&G for the initials of the German name for the company,
bought Fidelity Electronics in 1989. Up until that time, it was competing with Fidelity. It bought Fidelity for approximately $7 million. But by 1994, the company was in dire straits and was bought by Cytec Limited, also another maker of chess computers. Cytec was the company that bought Mephisto. So today, it's really a major player in producing and selling chess computers. It still uses Kasparov as its spokesperson. Novag is another company, another major producer of chess computers, and is still very active today, making especially travel and portable models. Most recently, it has released a new model called the Citrine.
So to recap, Fidelity was bought by Mephisto, which was bought by Cytec.
Just like any other collectibles, once you start collecting chess computers, it's very hard to quit.
I know, I said that I would quit. Alright, I promise no more after this. You don't know how I tried to forget what it was like. I remember now why they called it Thunderbird. Why they called it said that I desist. Alright, I promise no more after this. Not to be what I was like. Not to soar across the sky. Spread my thunder wings and fly. Spread my thunder wings and fly. I remember now. I remember now.
All the computers that we have seen so far are very interesting. But we're going to take a look at what I believe are the most interesting of all chess computers, and those are the chess-playing robots.
Robots have in common the fact that the system can move the pieces unassisted, so there is no human intervention. The pieces are moved by either a robotic arm or a system using magnets. Today, most of the robots that we see are either the result of research in universities, robotic enthusiasts, or something like that, but not really commercial products that you can buy. But back in the 80s and 90s, one could actually buy a chess-playing robot. So we are going to take a look at most of them right now.
Probably the most common chess playing robot is the Phantom from Fidelity. Actually, this model came from Milton Bradley. Looks like Fidelity bought the rights to produce the Phantom, and they enhanced the system. But this is a really nice system that every now and then we can see on eBay. Now, what's interesting about this system is the fact that it uses, it has magnetic pieces, so the computer can move the pieces by itself. What we're going to do is turn it on, and you can see another nice feature, that is the fact that as soon as you turn it on, it will automatically adjust the pieces. If you see here, the pieces are not centered, they're not aligned, and the computer can do that. So let's turn it on. And that's what it does first. That is, it will adjust all the pieces. And we'll take a look at that. It starts with the pawn. And then moves on to the major pieces. You know, the black pawns. So now that the pieces are all aligned, we can start playing. And the board is pressure sensitive, or pressure sensory. So we can actually press on the squares to register our moves, which are also registered on the LCD. And the computer will then make its move. So let's try it. Here, E2 to E4. So there we have it. The Phantom making its move. You can also ask for a hint or have the computer play against itself. So let's see what it suggests that we move. It will wiggle the piece that it suggests you move. Let's try it. So in this case, it's telling us that we should move our knight. But the actual move is registered here on the display. So you can see that's what it suggests that we move. It can also play against itself if we just press auto. It's actually going to do exactly what it asked us to. As the pieces are captured, it moves automatically to the side of the board. Even those who don't like chess computers, or chess in general, still like to see the Phantom playing, or any chess robot for that matter. Now that's the castle move. Now the Phantom came pretty much in two colors. I have here one system which I have only turned this on a couple times because it still has, as you can see, the original plastic that was that came from the factory. And this is the green, what I call the green Phantom. So this one, you don't see this one as much as you do the yellow one. When it is made available by collectors or people selling on eBay. Excalibur, the company that came after Fidelity, was founded by one of the sons of Sid Samoli from Fidelity. Also had a chess playing robot that we are going to take a look at next. This is the Mirage. This is the chess robot from Excalibur, and it works pretty much like the Phantom. It has a really nice chess program, and one thing that I like about it is that it runs on batteries. However, there are a few problems with it. Let's take a look at it. It does have 100 levels of play. The processor is on a 10 megahertz one, which is not bad for the time. You see here it has a teach mode that it's kind of neat. So here it is. Now, unlike the Phantom, it does not adjust the pieces. It does not, if they're not lined up correctly, you may have problems when you run it. It does play against itself, so let's try that. Now, as you have noticed, because the pieces, they don't line up perfectly, that causes problems. Sometimes I have actually seen pieces bump into each other. That's the castling move, and as you can see, the king is not really right in the center of the square, and that can cause problems. You can actually see the magnets on the pieces here. Now, I'll show you why a lot of people don't really care for the Mirage that much. I have here a non-working unit, pretty much the same model, and I'll show you what it looks like inside. Unlike the Phantoms, it's not a unit that seems to be sturdy and well-built. And looking inside of it, you can see how simple the mechanism is. But what you can also see here is that maybe because it was made in China, I don't know, it's not really a unit that is known for its durability. Here's an interesting part that I saw. You see here how it has this rubber band around the motor? Well, that's pretty much a standard part that I have seen in just about every Mirage that I have seen open. So it's a unit that I do like it, but there are lots of problems with it.
Now we're going to see a very special and very rare chess computer, this one here. This is the Novak Robot Adversary, and as you can see, what makes this model so special is the fact that it has a robotic arm that can pick up the pieces and move them around the board and even put them on the sides once the pieces are captured. Now, this unit, unfortunately, is not working. There's a problem with the arm, so we can only show you so much. And the way it works is, it has an auto-sensory board. The pieces, as you can see, they have magnets. And as you place them on the board, even as you set up, the board also has magnets underneath them. So here's what happens when you put the piece in, you don't put them right in the center. See? And as you can see, it is turned on. So as you move the pieces, the computer recognizes the move, and if the arm was working, you could see the arm moving, picking up the piece, and even place them on the sides. It was made by Novak, and again, the model is the Robot Adversary. It was released in the 80s, and again, it's very rare, especially in working condition.
Now, in 2006, I had a chance to visit Germany and meet a fellow collector, and he had a working Novag Adversary, so you have a chance to see it working here.
So I must wait till it's finished, huh? Then I make my next move. And here's a small memory for opening this, huh? And he's playing pretty aggressively, yeah? Open this one. And you know, he takes the pawn. It's also quite interesting, yeah? He moves his pawn to this place, but yeah, he still continues his move. These are his emotions.
He
shows his emotions on the one hand here, yeah, and he also shows his emotions with his through his sound.
Okay.
Yeah? And the next move, I will make a big mistake, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And you will see how happy he will be, and he will, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So I will make a mistake. Now I take this bishop here, for he can take it, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And now he will start to be very happy. He still can't believe it.
He's trying to see what you're up to.
Yeah. He's happy now, yeah? He walks somewhere over the board, yeah?
Yeah? I got it.
And now he doesn't do anything. Oh, okay, let's try take it, yeah?
No, he takes it.
These are his emotions.
Oh, that's great!
That is amazing.
I can deactivate them, but I can activate them, yeah?
Mm-hmm. That is pretty amazing.
Yeah.
I liked it. And here we have something we don't see every day. All the three Milton Bradley models side by side. And let's have them play against themselves and we'll show you a little bit of each one of them. Well, they are pretty much the same computer, except they're all made by Milton Bradley, but each one was released in a different country. This one, the Phantom, is the UK version and is the rarest because it is the hardest one to find, but they're all by Milton Bradley. This one here was called the Grandmaster and was released in the US. And finally, the one that was called simply the Milton was released in Germany. So you can see here in the controls all the German notation. But they are my favorite ones of all my computers. And you can see how they really amaze people up to this day. Even though they were released in the early 80s, just because they move their own pieces, and that is something that people really enjoy seeing. Here we see it castling. And as you can see, as the pieces are captured, it automatically moves them to the sides. It's really an amazing piece of technology. And the way it works is, the pieces have magnets on them. And underneath the board, you do have an axis
a series of a y-axis and a power magnet that goes around and captures the pieces and releases it when it reaches its destination. At the end of a game, it automatically resets the pieces to their original position. I'll show you that. Start, new game. You see the pieces all going back to their original places. Let's show again how it automatically adjusts the pieces as you place them on the center. See that? Now let's see. It will probably take my bishop, I hope. Removes the capture pieces and then places the pawn where it's supposed to be. Finally, we're going to take a look at the last phantom produced, which is also the most interesting of all. It's the model 6126 Chester or Eyeball, as it's also known, and you'll see why. Let's turn it on.
Hi, I'm Chester. How about a nice game of chess?
As you can see, this is a talking phantom. It has the same features as the other phantoms, which is that. It has the same features as the other phantom that we saw, but it talks and also it has motion sensor, and we'll take a look at that.
Are you sure you want a new game? All right. Hi, I'm Chester.
The reason why it's called the eyeball is because of these two LEDs here and here. The idea is to simulate a human opponent looking at you as you play with it. And here you can see the motion sensor. So it senses when somebody walks right in front of the computer or makes a movement and it starts talking based on that. If you leave the computer standing for a long time, it will sort of hibernate, and as soon as somebody comes right in front of it, it will start come back, it comes back to life. So that was a very interesting concept.
Hey you! Yes you! Come over here! Hi, I'm Chester. How about a nice game of chess? Press any key and I'll show you how to play. Press any key and I'll show you how to play. Press any key and I'm glad you stopped by. Are the pieces set up? Alright, we're ready for a game of chess. You're white. It's your turn. First, you have to tell me what piece you're moving. Use the piece to press on its square. D2. Great, now pick up the pawn and press on the square you want to move to. D4. Great, you just played a move. Knight on G8 to F6. What you can do is move your pawn on C2. Next time, give me a problem to think about. I get bored looking at the same dumb position. C1. H7. That move is illegal because the bishop can't move like that. Now press on the square you want to move to. To clear your move, press on C1. It's your move. Knight on F6. Pawn on E4 takes pawn on F3. Sure, you're playing better. But you're taking more time than me. Put me on a higher level if you're going to take so long. It's your move, you know. Ahem, are you still there? Give me your rook. This game is giving me a headache. Okay, you won this one.
How about a nice game of chess?
Well, that's all, folks. I hope you enjoyed some of what you saw. Today we mostly play chess using our computers because they're so much powerful than some of the machines that we saw, actually all of them. But it's still important to preserve the history of these machines, the dedicated chess computers, and see how we got where we are today. So thanks for watching, and I hope to see you in the future, maybe in the fall, not to move.
I don't want to calculate every line of a maiden eight. I don't want to sit and stare and get control of an empty square. I don't want to study and remember every single move that was ever made. If I'm going to work that hard, I want to get paid.
When John Henry was a little baby,
oh yeah,
sitting on his daddy's knee,
on his knee,
he picked up a chessboard and 16 pawns and said, chess will be the death of me, Lord, Lord, chess will be the death of me. Well, the captain said to John Henry,
hey, Johnny,
gonna bring a computer on the team.
That's right.
Gonna put that computer up on first board. Gonna put you on board 16, poor boy. Gonna put you on board 16. Well, John Henry said to the captain,
wait a minute.
Well, a rook ain't nothing but a rook. Before I let that chess computer beat me down, I die with my finger in an opening book. Die with my finger in a book. Take it.
Chess players are tough.
John Henry attacked the computer with every variation he could find.
Take that.
He fought so hard, he broke his poor heart. Laid down his king and resigned, Lord, Lord. Laid down his king and resigned. The man who wrote the chess program,
that's me.
Well, he thought he was mighty fine.
I'm mighty fine.
'Cause John Henry announced a mate in 15 moves. The computer made it him in only 9, Lord, Lord. The computer made it him in only 9. Well, John Henry had a little baby.
Oh.
You could hold him in the palm of your hand.
The last thing I heard that
poor boys say were. My daddy was a chess playing man, Lord, Lord. My daddy was a chess playing man.
His daddy was a chess playing man.